All right, freshly greased servo, and oh, wrong video. Sorry, I'll put that away. Roll the intro. All right, welcome back to Striking FPV R&D. My name's Ashton, and this is part two of the anatomy of a cinematic FPV flight, specifically the part where I sit down and show you how I actually went about editing the thing. If you're lucky, and this goes really quickly and smooth, then I'll also show a little bit of the 3D tech stuff. If not, then that might have to go on to the next video. But yeah, if you haven't seen the previous one, I basically walked around the reservoir where everything was done and talked you through how I kind of planned the shot, reasons why I did various things. And so today is now the actual editing part. So how do I ingest all of the content and, you know, stabilize the footage and then go about editing the thing? Right, this is now take number 7. So the thing I said in the last video about shooting at home being easier, not at all. Anyway, I'll try to keep this short and brief because I'm running out of patience at this point. So how's this work? I'm in Adobe Premiere Pro. Why am I using it? I've kind of always used it and I still have access to it for my work, so it makes sense for me to continue doing so. But there's no reason why you couldn't do any of this in DaVinci Resolve, which is free and a fantastic piece of software, excellent for color grading. I'm not a super expert color grader. I have a shortcut for doing that kind of stuff, so you'll see a bit of that a little later. But yeah, you can follow along if you're an editor already. If you've never edited before, maybe this will be a little bit of insight to what it takes to actually produce a video like what I like to do. So let's get started. Press play. This is the timeline, and this is how Adobe Premiere Pro usually looks, or at least is the way that I've set it up. And it's a fantastic way to preview things, because you get to see on the timeline down here where all the stuff is. So I have the main clip on track 1. We've got my watermark on track number 2. Track number 3. Track number 2, which is coming up, is going to be where my 3D graphics go. So you'll notice up here, Chalong Reservoir, music hits. That's the whole flow. And if we skip a little bit further along, you'll also notice this little watermark on the bottom left, which highlights how far away from home, the home point. That's basically the video. If we go to the audio segment, you'll notice that this very long continuous kind of section here, well, this is the music. You've got a couple cuts in here because I want certain sections to be a bit longer, and the original track is actually not long enough to fit the whole thing, so. Then further down on the additional audio tracks, which I can show here, this is where all the magic happens regarding the sound. So sound design for me plays a significant role in making the video feel more real. Is real the right word? Or at least more immersive. You know, you could put just the music, but the problem with just the music is that it's only music. All the environment sounds that you sort of imagine in your head don't appear. Now, if you're really up high, you think you're going to be fighting through a bit of wind, so you're going to hear that. Or if you fly through leaves, trees, and stuff like that, you want to hear that rustling. Near the ocean, you want to hear the waves crashing. Sound design is kind of crucial. I realized that when I was a full-time videographer. My earliest videos didn't have much sound design, aside from when people spoke, or when there was a crucial thing that you cannot not have a sound. Wine glass being poured. But if you can build that ambience outside of the music, it really does add to the production value, which is why I do it. So that's the basic premise of how all this works. For the 3D stuff, I will briefly mention before we continue that this clip here, if I zoom in, it's actually an After Effects composition. So that's the only thing in this series. I probably won't do it in this video. It'll be a part 3 where I explain how I do the actual 3D text, but I do that in Adobe After Effects. Makes sense, obviously, because After Effects and Premiere Pro link to one another. So this is actually an After Effects file composition that's just dragged into Adobe. And so any changes that I make to After Effects over here will then be reflected in Adobe. What's up with all the dogs barking? I hope you can't hear that. Anyway, So, how am I going to do this? Well, let's actually begin by closing this project. This one. I've already worked on this a little bit, but you know what? Let's start it from scratch. I'm going to delete everything. There. Fresh start. So, what do we need to do? First things first, I need to import all the footage. So, the way I'll do this, there are a couple ways to do it actually. In the project area, I will right click import, and then I'll go find the footage. In this case, I've saved it on my external SSD under this folder, striking FPV, and then we have what? Chalong Reservoir, and then all the files are here. I'll briefly show you how I've laid everything out. Audio folder just has all the sound effects that I've collected over the last couple years. Most of them come from the YouTube audio library. Some of them I've recorded myself. A couple others I think have come from other random videos where like people offer sound effects for free. For every single video I do, I kind of accrue new sound effects. I basically look at my footage and I'm like, okay, what do I need? So have I got cicadas in the forest? Okay, I'll bring that file in. Is there wind? Of course there's wind. It's a drone, right? So I need the wind sounds, the whooshy sounds for transitions and all that stuff. Trees, leaves rustling, all of that stuff. Waves crashing, you name it. If it's in that video and I know that I'm gonna need it, then I prepare it, I put it into the audio folder, and that's all good. So, select audio, import. And now you have a folder filled with all of that stuff. Let's right-click import again. We'll go to clips. So here you'll notice there's two versions of every clip. And basically it's the original GoPro file, which if I play for you briefly, you'll notice is horribly fisheyed and 4x3. It's like an old TV. And the reason why it's like that is because it gives the stabilization software, ReelSteady GO, the most real estate with which to crop in and create the final stabilized footage. This is a terrible example because this is the flight there where I used too dark an ND filter and too short shutter speed, so I couldn't use it. But let's open the one that I ended up using. There you go. Look at that. Nice and bright. And if I click ahead, you'll notice that you see how the footage is shaky and janky, and you can actually see the props in shot, bottom right and bottom left. That's how this actually looks like straight out of the camera. So you then have to open this up in ReelSteady. So if I type in ReelSteady GO. Now, if you've got ReelSteady GO, you may have also received that email from GoPro that allows you to load ReelSteady in their new app. That worked for me briefly, and then it stopped working. I recently contacted GoPro support about 2 weeks ago, and they said they'll look into it, and so far nothing, so thanks GoPro. But for now, ReelSteady GO still works. So if you click load, select the clip that you want to smooth, and what it's going to do is it's going to run the numbers. What does that mean? Well, basically, the GoPro, when it records, has gyro data included with the video. And what it will do is it will compare that gyro data with footage and try to process and create a stabilized image with less fisheye and, you know, a lot kind of smoother stuff. So by the time it's finished processing, there's my knee. We can click ahead and you'll notice that it's not playing back at full speed, which is the downside of the old ReelSteady. The new one plays back at full speed, which is nice. But the footage is indeed stabilized. And what I tend to do is I'll click on the settings icon on the bottom right, and I'll just increase the smoothness a little bit, which also drags the cropping speed slider across. And I'll drag the cropping speed across as well. What's the cropping speed? Basically, the footage is like this big. To stabilize it, it's cropping in like this, and then shifting the image and rotating it around to make it smooth. But when the footage is already steady, it'll crop out to show as much footage as it can. When the footage starts to get really hectic, then it will crop in. So the cropping speed basically changes how quickly it crops in and out. And you'll get this breathing effect if the cropping speed is set to fast or normal. So I like to slow it down and it just helps. Anyway, once you click OK, it's gonna recompute the smoothness. It's gonna take forever to do that, and eventually we'll be able to save the video. I will say the GoPro Player app, if you do get ReelSteady GO working on there, it gives you more options for newer GoPros. ReelSteady GO for me still works. If I do get the new GoPro, then I'm really gonna shout at the customer support people at GoPro and say, yo, why am I not getting access to the new one? I had it briefly, but anyway, that's another story. Once you're happy with this, you click save and it's going to start rendering, which I'm going to stop because I already rendered it out earlier. So let's just kill the task and you'll see it's actually created a new file called smoothed.one, which I don't need because I already have smoothed here. Anyway, so that's the clip section. I'm going to click import folder. And just to be a little bit different, I'm going to show you that if I go directly to the area, the folder within Windows Explorer, I can also just drag and drop music. And if we look at music, there's actually two tracks in there because I originally thought this might be an option. No, it's not. This one became the final song, as you know. Anyway, the only other thing that I need to actually process is branding, because I've got my intros and I've got the watermarks. So I'll right click, make a new bin, call it branding. Right click again, import, and I'll go to where I saved that stuff, which is my documents, striking FPV, logo, and then I've got here, striking FPV intro, striking FPV title, the 1:1 watermark and the 16:9 watermark, open, and that imports there. We can have a look at them. That's for Instagram. This is for everything else. Short intro and long buzzy outro, which now that I think about it, doesn't really need to be that long, but anyway, what's done is done. Consistency and branding is key. So now what do I do? Let's see, let's go to clips. And I know that this is the actual shot that I ended up using. So what we'll do, you double click it, it opens up in the source monitor. And this allows you to preview footage without messing with anything else. So we'll just quickly do that here. I'll skip ahead to the point where I know the video starts. In the usual process, I'll just scrub through it and find the point that I think feels right. In this case, it's roughly here where you get the whole reservoir in the shot. So I will right click and mark in. Then we're going to skip ahead to, I know there's a point where I do a backflip. Okay, I've already done it. So if I scrub back. You notice how the playback isn't smooth. If you have a newer computer, it'll probably be a bit smoother. My computer is about 2.5 years old. It was mid-range back then, so it's definitely not mid-range anymore. Still does the job, can't complain. Some of you might be on even lesser powered machines, in which case I'm sorry to hear that, and some of you might be on hyper-powered gaming machines, in which case I secretly hate you. Anyway, I skip ahead by using the arrow keys on the keyboard to the point where I think makes sense for a cut. That's roughly here. I will right click mark out and I will now drag it onto my timeline. There's no timeline there, but if you let go, it will create one for you. So if I close the clips folder, I now have this new timeline. I'm going to rename it to YouTube sequence because I tend to make many sequences, one for Facebook, one for Instagram and yada, yada, yada. And you'll notice that it's at 50 frames a second. And if I go to the sequence settings, it's also kind of a weird resolution because that's the resolution that the GoPro pumps out when you record at 2.7K. I've recently started shooting at 4K. I don't get as much of a high frame rate because I'm only running the Hero 8, but that is what it is. So first of all my videos are in 30 frames a second. So I'm going to set that to 30. Now the keen-eyed of you will notice that 30 does not divide into 50. You're correct, but we're going to sort that out later. The frame size should be 2560 by 1440 because that is a real resolution that you can actually get in a monitor. If I leave this at full HD, it's going to result in larger video preview files and it's also going to potentially not play back as smooth as I wish. So I'm just going to set this to 720p to be safe. I'm going to click OK. You'll also notice that the footage cropped in because this footage here is actually a little bit larger than 2560 by 1440. The solution to that is to right click the footage and click scale to frame size. And that will just shrink it that little bit to make it fit. It also gives us a little bit of extra downsampling, which in theory increases the sharpness of the footage by a tiny little bit and the grading quality, but not as much as if you were downsizing from like 4K to 2560, but that's a different story. Anyway, what now? So, here's the issue. This footage is at 50 frames a second and the timeline is at 30, which means there's going to be uneven sort of frame pacing. So if I play it back, you'll notice, well, not maybe not here, but like there. It's got this slight stutter where it's like having to double up on a frame or skip two frames. So that is an issue. Well, my solution is this. Right click, speed duration, 120%. This has now sped up my footage by 20%, but it's also lined up all the frames perfectly. So effectively, I've changed the frame rate to 60 frames a second, or 30 divides into 60, and that now sorts out the smoothness. If I play it back, look how smooth it is. Now, is this dishonest? Maybe slightly, but I've always told people when they ask me my GoPro settings, I shoot in 25 or 50, and I speed everything up by 20% to get it running at 30. That allows me to fly a little bit slower and safer because I don't want to damage the drone or hit people. And it also allows for a little bit more excitement in the final product. And that's what I've been doing with all my videos. So that's my secret. When people ask me, is that real speed? I usually say kind of yes, because I'm not doubling the speed. I'm only increasing it by a little bit. Similar trick I used to do back in my videography days is to shoot in 30, but then produce videos at 24 frames a second. And that's also about a 20% speed decrease. So it's not slow motion, but it's a little bit kind of slow motion. It gives the motion this kind of ethereal vibe to it without being obviously slow-mo. So I'm kind of reapplying that trick in this case, except instead of slowing it down, we're speeding it up. So it is what it is. We play it back, it now looks smooth. But the only other thing that is not quite right is the color. Let's full screen this so you can see. This is the standard GoPro flat color profile. And the flat color profile is as described, a little bit flat. It's not as flat as a real colorist would prefer. Like we want, you know, Sony have S-Log, Nikon have, what do they have, N-Log? I don't know. And that's a really muted kind of look. And it's fantastic for color grading. Flat is the best you get out of the GoPro, and it comes across flat. It's more gradable than the standard color. So if you are using GoPro, please switch to flat. You can color grade better later. Anyway, I now need to make it look like all my other videos, and I have a shortcut for that. And that shortcut is over in the effects panel. I have a preset that's been saved called GoPro Hero 8. If I drag it across, bam, I have my look. Now I need to tweak it a little bit more, but that's basically how it is. But how do I create it from scratch? Well, let's click on the footage, go to Effect Controls, and if I have a look, you see this little thing called Lumetri Color. Let's delete that so I can show you how you can do it from scratch. Let's just search Lumetri. If you type Lumetri, it gives you all the other presets, which we don't necessarily need. If I press space and type in color, so Lumetri Color, there. Video Effects, Color Correction, Lumetri Color. We can drag that onto there, and this gives us our color correction effect on that clip. But there's an easy way to do this, so I'm gonna delete that, and we're just gonna click on the color tab up on the top, and that brings us to this layout. So I don't normally change layouts very often in Adobe Premiere, but in this case, it's very handy for the color grading, because now I have the scopes, which tells me, you know, where the colors are in terms of 0 being black, 255 being white, and then I have this panel on the right, which is like the real, where the real magic happens. So if you don't know much about color grading and sort of photography and whatever, I've done photography as well, you have roughly the same sliders. You've got the tint, which changes color to like green and magenta. Double click will reset it. And you've got the color temperature, where you can make things colder or make things warmer. So if you go like over here, now it's kind of a Breaking Bad kind of vibe, right? Anyway, double click that, goes back to normal. Then you can also adjust things like exposure. You notice as I make all these changes, the Lumetri scopes on the left also change to show you where the sort of color distribution is. Contrast can be made deeper or less. And if I make it a lot less, this is actually what logarithmic log footage looks like out of like professional cameras. Even more muted than that, maybe like this. There, this is what log footage would look like. Anyway, so that's contrast. Highlights brings down brightness in the brighter parts of the image. So like clouds, you'll notice get affected more. Shadows brings up the brightness in dark parts of the image. So you'll notice that, you know, in the trees where it's dark, if I slide that up and down, that's actually affecting that. And it doesn't affect the clouds as much. Finally, the whites really affects the whitest parts of the image, and then blacks affects the blackest part of the image. Then you have saturation, which controls how much color is present in the whole image. So that's kind of how all this works. Now what I'm going to do is reset these. So like I said, double click all of these and that will reset them back to zero. Now here's where the magic really happens. Lookup tables. If you don't know what a lookup table is, basically it's a file that has basically a 3D cube of colors and how they correspond to standard colors. That's a really poor explanation, but the general idea is in the lookup table, if you get this color, in the lookup table it will say, well, replace it with this color. So what that means is if I load one up, so let's say custom, I've got saved these lookup tables here, these LUTs. They come in 3DL and cube files. I downloaded these a long time ago from somebody offering free LUTs. You can find loads of people still doing that, and you've got paid ones. So if there's like your favorite creator has a LUT and you really want to look like them, then pay them and you can get the same look. I'm not into that. I'll stick with the free stuff and mess with it. So I load that and ooh, look at that. This is the classic travel. This is the cliche travel kind of look, teal and orange, which I do like to some degree, but that's way too intense. So here you have the intensity slider, which reduces the strength of the lookup table to zero. Back to our standard footage. I like to go about 50%, maybe a little bit less. So let's try 45%. And now you see my footage just has that little bit of extra kind of niceness to it. If I turn off this little checkbox here, we can compare before and after. And you can see where my footage starts to look a bit nicer. Maybe we can add a bit more. Whoa, 200, too much. 50 is what I want. And when we go back to basic correction, I also want a bit more color, so I'll set that to like 120. There, it brings a bit more yellows into the trees. And then maybe 125. Let's also increase the temperature to give it a warmer feel, maybe a little bit more magenta. And that's actually how I created the preset. So if I now go back to the assembly thing and I show you, let's close that. And I show you my preset there, GoPro Hero 8. This is roughly the look. So I can now delete this and just drag this one back on. And there you go, done. A bit more contrasty, and that's fine. And we'll stick with that. This is not the final look in the final video, but for the purposes of showing you how I do all of this stuff, you know, this can be the look for this rendition. So let's save. Always remember to save, because you can do a lot of stuff. And Adobe, despite being, you know, years in development, there's a lot of leftover code that occasionally throws a spanner in the works and it can just crash randomly and you will lose all your stuff. So save frequently. Control S is your friend, Command S if you're on Mac. You know, get in your head. Just every time you do something and you feel that little bit of satisfaction, like, oh yeah, this is going well, save. You really should save. Anyway, as we continue, the next thing is, I mentioned that there's a transition point, right? So if I play this and we get to the transition point, watch out, we're gonna do the backflip and footage ends, because that's the cutting point. So how do we do this? Well, let's go back to our clips. And I know that it's the next piece of footage, 10191 smooth. This is actually the footage from the Cinewhoop where I fly through. This is the trench run from Star Wars, right? So basically I did a couple test flights through here to make sure that the signal was safe before I went for the final shot. And indeed the signal was okay. I didn't get that much degradation. I got a little bit, but anyway. So this is roughly where I came in from. I should have come in shallower, but you know, can't redo it. I'll just use the keyboard to skip ahead to roughly where I want the backflip to occur. This is where the sky looks the most featureless. So let's right click, mark in, and then we'll scrub ahead to roughly where the video ended, which was, oh yeah, around here. I actually had plans to continue the video and like try to make a seamless thing into the temple, but I felt like it made the video way too long. And so I kind of just ended it roughly here. So let's right click, mark out. If you're wondering how I full screen this, I don't think I mentioned how I did it. You press the tilde key and basically any window that you have selected will be full screened inside Adobe Premiere. So even the project area, all of effects, everything, which is pretty handy. Anyway, once that's selected, I'm then gonna drag the footage down to here and just smash it up against that. Now remember, that footage is at a slightly higher resolution than the timeline, and it's also at a slightly higher frame rate. So right click and scale the frame size, and then also right click speed duration 120%. I will mention one other thing. You can actually reconform the footage, which means you don't have to set the speed in here. And the way you would do that, let me just undo the speed correction, is you select the footage over here and you notice it says 50 frames per second at the frame rate. Oh, let's do this one. That makes more sense. If I right click that and go to modify, interpret footage, we can then assume this frame rate and basically tell it to be 60 frames a second instead of 50. If I click OK, you'll notice this footage is now at 100% speed, but the playback is smooth because I've told the footage that it should be 60 frames per second. This is a better way to do it than what I previously did. So that's how I do it for the future. Anyway, only other thing, let's drag the color on board. Done, got the same color. And let's check the transition. Does it work? Will it blend? Those videos are old, love them though. Not bad. That was pretty decent. I'll full screen that, well, not full screen. Let's do this. And that's pretty seamless. Now, the last video, you'll also notice that I said, don't do a crossfade. So just to demonstrate, I'll type into effects cross, and you've got crossfade for sound as well. But we have dissolve under video transitions. We drag this over to where the clips meet, and this is a kind of inbuilt crossfade and also fade to black function if you want. And if we now have a look at it, ooh, you see the problem there. So this is why you don't crossfade, is sometimes you get this weird ghosting where one piece of footage is overlaid over the other. So the way to solve that is to just reduce the transition time and hopefully that will sort it out. Ooh, you see the clouds are now also doing that weird thing, so maybe even less. Maybe slide it forward. Oh, you know what? That worked. Have a look at that. So this is the middle of the crossfade. And yeah, it's a little bit odd because of that point, but it's not bad. Now, if you want finer control of the crossfade, if you click on the item there and click on effect controls, it actually shows you the crossfade up here and you can reduce it even further. So I can try shifting it around. What about this? Make it even more abrupt. I think I like that. Let's play it back. Well, there you go. Don't listen to my advice. Sometimes you can crossfade and make it look nice, but sometimes you don't need to, like I did earlier. So there is that. Anyway, so now I have the base footage where I want it to be. What's next? Well, there's this meme that I saw on the internet one time about, it's like a pie chart about the time spent editing a video. And there's like one small section is like 20% editing the video. The other 80% selecting music, which back in the day, yeah, 100% true. Finding the music that really fits is so crucial. I currently use the YouTube audio library because it's mostly free. Although recently I've started noticing issues with Facebook. Luckily, Facebook also has an audio library. So for all your meta stuff, Instagram, Facebook, that's how I select the music. I'm now going to open the music folder and select this, Lauren Dusky, Jindupe, don't know how you pronounce it. And we're going to drag it into the timeline and ooh, that song is way too short for the footage that I currently have. So I'm going to have to go back to the front and we're going to have to work on that. And that's going to be the next kind of interesting challenge, is how to extend music. And if you download from a service like, I believe it's Premium Beat, also Epidemic Sound, I think some of those services offer the music in chunks so you can like easily drag and drop each chunk to make one section longer or shorter or whatever. From the audio libraries, you don't get that. You just get the track as it was meant to be listened to. And that's the point where you have to start working on cutting the music. So we'll get into that now. So let's actually see how this flows. Well, let's skip ahead. Because crucially, I have a point where I want to put the text and that's where the music kind of hits. So if we skip ahead to where that music hits, let's see how it flows. And that's too late. So actually the music where it does this is supposed to happen as I cross over the text, and crossing over the text happens around here. So this is where I want the music to hit, right? Now, the easiest way to sort this out, I find, is if I just drag this clip all the way back to this point, I can now zoom in. By the way, to zoom in, Control Alt and the mouse wheel will zoom on the timeline, which is really handy. I can then zoom in, place my timeline position scroll arrow thing, I don't know, whatever you call it, place the position of where I am in the clip at the point where I want the hit to occur, and then I will drag that, oh, careful, hang on. So if I drag that clip, I'm gonna overlap this one. So I need to select both clips, zoom back in, and we're gonna drag that across, and it will snap into place. If snap's not working for you and you're in Adobe, there's this little thing over here, snap in timeline. If I turn that off, it doesn't snap anywhere. But if I turn it on, it starts snapping. You can also press S on the keyboard, which does the same job. There you go. And that's now the point where the music hits and I cross over the sign. At this point, I can zoom out again and just drag the clip back to the beginning. And so I have that point keyed in exactly where I want it. To be fair, it can actually occur just a little bit after. So I can drag that across here, drag that to the beginning, try one more time, full screen it for effect. I'm happy with that. That works. Okay, so there we are for that. That has changed the timing for the beginning though. So let's go back to the beginning. And oh yeah, that's kind of weird. So that's not a very smooth beginning. Well, you'll notice in my original video, the beginning starts off with like a 25% fade. So we can do that in one of two ways. Like I mentioned before, the cross dissolve feature, if you don't put it at the border of two clips that are pressed up against one another, you can actually put it at the beginning and it will fade from black, which is kind of nice. That works. It's a bit abrupt, so I want it to be a bit longer, so I can select it, and you know, it's hard to drag from here. If I zoom in though, scroll forward, and I get this, I can then drag it out and make that fade slower, like so, which is also very nice. But I also don't want the video to start completely black for various reasons I can get into later. What I want it to do is to start from like 25%, so we won't use a cross dissolve. Let's delete that. Instead, we'll go into the effect controls, and this is where, if you don't know what keyframing is, you're about to find out. Keyframing is the act of setting a value at a specific point in time on the clip, and you can set values to be different amounts at different points in the timeline and on the clip, and what will happen is the values will slowly, smoothly change between these keyframes. And so what I'll do first is I will click this little stopwatch over here by opacity. Opacity is a fancy word for the opposite of transparency. If you can see straight through it, it's transparent. If you can't see through it at all, it's opaque. So opacity is how opaque it is. So if I click on the little stopwatch there, it creates a keyframe at this point of 100% opacity. I then move my marker, my timeline marker thing, across to the beginning of the footage, and I can type in here 25%, and you notice the whole thing becomes dimmer because it's transparent, 25% opacity, and there's nothing in the back. That bird's loud. Nothing on the back, it's just a black, you know, screen, so 25% means it starts off like this, and if we now play it, that's the look I actually had in the final video, which I do not mind. So we'll go with that. That's now our beginning. This is also the point where I want to fade in the watermark. So if we go to branding, and we select, there you go, this is the 16:9 one, and I drag it on top, and drag it across the whole piece of footage. You will now notice that nothing appears there. Why is that? Well, because this footage is actually at 4K. So if you look at the program area, it means that the watermark is off screen. So once again, like we did with the footage itself, we can right click this and click scale to frame size. And that now puts striking FPV at the correct place. but it's very in your face. I could set it to 50% opacity, but it's still kind of in your face. So I decided I wanted a watermark that was a little bit more casual, kind of ghostly in a way. Doesn't appear, doesn't distract from the footage unless you stare at it. And the way you can do that is by selecting a different blend mode. So if there's this effect called overlay, if I click that, it now is even dimmer, but it behaves in a funny way. So if I play back the footage, I'll turn down the volume a bit. The way it sort of interacts with everything. In fact, can we do this? There we go. Notice how it's affected by the footage beneath it. It's not a straight up sort of normal where it's like this, and it's not straight up screen where it's a bit faded. If I put it to overlay, it takes on more of the color of what's beneath it, and so it has a more interesting effect. And that's what I have been using on all of my videos so far. Anyway, we'll set this back to fit, and we can continue on our adventure. Actually, no, I need to fade this in. So I want it to fade in here roughly, and we'll use the cross dissolve. And now if you watch, it fades in nicely. So there's that. And you can do the same at the end when the whole thing is done. And say it fades out. Where does the footage end? It ends about here. So let's say it fades out there. Striking FPV disappears, and then I can fade out to something else. Anyway, that was a tangent. I was supposed to tell you how to deal with the music. Well, let's deal with the music now. So I want the music to last a bit longer than where it currently is. So let's listen to it and see how it flows. That's cool. You see it flying through that gap and you get that hit. Okay, so this is interesting. You see the music here has calmed, right? But I'm still flying kind of acrobatically. So this is a point where I'm like, maybe I want the music to still be upbeat. So how does this work? Now, if you know anything about music, most music has four beats to a bar. What does that mean? It's sort of like when beats happen and when the music flows, there's kind of four sections before it repeats. And that's kind of, that's a very vague way to describe it. But listen here. One, two, three, four, one, two. That's the basic premise here. So if you didn't know that's how music works, now you do. What do we do with this information? Well, this can guide us on how we can cut the music, right? So we got to find the kind of the one point. So this is the one point. Now, if we zoom in, we can actually have a look at the waveform, and you'll start to see shapes in the music waveform, which can tell you where a beat happens to fall, where the beginning of a section actually is. And you can see quite clearly here that this is that point. Unfortunately, I can't cut directly on that point because of the frame rate. There is a way to sort this out, but I find I don't really need to, so I'm not going to deal with it. I'm basically going to select just a little bit in front, and this can be our in point. And now what we need to do is cut the clip there. And the way I cut is with a shortcut, Control K, because cut is spelt with a K. Control K, and now the clip has actually been sliced into two sections, which I can now drag around. So that means the music will end at that point. Three, four, and it's gone. I'll undo that, because here's the next thing. We now need to find a way to extend it. And the easiest way to do that is to find where the next one comes in. So if we continue to listen from this point, one, two, three, four, one. So this is where the next thing should start, but it becomes quiet, right? So if I move my little marker back to roughly this point, again, a little bit before the one, I can then Control C or Command C to copy this clip. And because I've got the correct timeline selected, the correct track selected, if I press Control V and paste it, oop, it skipped ahead. But now if we look back, you'll notice that this section has now been repeated. And now what we should do is listen to it to make sure it actually flows correctly. Because if there's a little bit of a gap or delay or it comes a little bit early, it's a little bit jarring. So we'll just have a quick listen here. So for me, that was slightly delayed. And this is another neat shortcut in Adobe, which I like. If you hold the Alt button and then use the arrow keys, that will allow you to shift the clips by one frame. So I'm just gonna move it forward so that it comes in a little bit earlier, that slight bit earlier. Like so, and we're gonna listen again. There you go. That's where we're at. And then see where it becomes calm. See where my flying becomes a bit smoother and then the music can stay calm. Yes. So, am I happy with that? Do I want the calmness to stay around just a little bit longer and get the hit when I do that dive? Because you see where I dive here, right? Because after this tree, this gap, I've then got the hectic area there, which I don't fly through. We've talked about this in the last video. Leave me alone. So, I want to extend this quiet section by a little bit. So, we're going to do the exact same process, just to demonstrate. Where does it become quiet? There. So, we're going to go back, and I'm going to cut. Control-K to cut. Press play. There. This is the repeat point, the one. And again, you can see the waveform in the timeline to kind of guide where you should cut. So for me, that's where it is. I put the marker there, Control K to cut it. And now we've got our slow section kind of sorted out here. Is that where I want to do? Oh, actually no. So what I can do here instead is copy this and just paste. We can delete the rest of that and then drag it out again. And so now you can see I've extended the slow section by four bars that have just occurred here. So if I press play here, press calm, two, three, four. Here's an interesting thing. If you listen to that, this is where it becomes interesting when you edit music, because if you actually go back to the beginning here, where the actual calm part starts, the previous section kind of ends and the calm part starts off fresh by itself. But if you listen to where the calm part continues by itself, here, the lingering section of the calm part before it repeats continued into the next section, and you don't quite get that at this point because I've basically cut the beginning of the calm part to come halfway through the calm part, which means that kind of lingering on doesn't occur. It feels a bit dry. So there's a couple ways to do this. Since I've synced it up so well, I could just choose another point along here and drag this out and have the transition point somewhere else. And it kind of works, but it's still, there's something that's not quite right. It still feels a bit too dry. So I'm gonna undo that. And this is where we get to use the crossfading feature for music. So if we go again, you type in cross under effects, drag constant power. By using that, what will now happen is that lingering on sound that you get from the previous section here will basically be faded into the next section, and it should sound smoother. So here it is. You see how it doesn't sound dry anymore. Let's listen again without that. And now with. A lot smoother, isn't it? If you don't notice that, well, sorry, can't help you. I notice it. I'm sort of a musician, so that kind of gets to me. But now, if you look at the footage, diving in. So it's not perfect. I could retime the footage, that's a topic for another day. But that does roughly get the flow that I want, so I'm kind of okay with that. Let's save there for a moment. And what I'll do, this exact same thing for the rest of the track, really, for the rest of the video, really quickly. And through the magic of editing, we are back. Well, it's a bit meta. It's the magic of editing the video about editing a video. It is what it is. Anyway, so I'm back, and honestly, I've just copy-pasted the music that I already did from the previous thing, so there you go. Now, the challenge is to do the sound. At least, for this video, the challenge is to do the sound. We'll do the 3D text later, so stay tuned. Anyway, or subscribe! I hate asking for subscribers, but yeah, do it if you want. Click subscribe, ring the bell, whatever. So, now we got to do the sound effects. How are we going to do that? Well, let's actually have a look and see. Let's close that. At what sounds we want and how we're going to plan it. So, if you recall the original video, it starts off really way up high with that kind of like calm, big vista vibe. And you can imagine in your head that while you're up there, it's going to be like kind of calm winds or like kind of deep sounding-ish winds. So what we're going to do, we're going to go into my audio folder. I'm going to find the one that I want, Desert Howling Wind. I don't think it's this one, but let's listen anyway. Wow, that's really quiet. And that's... Okay, no, that does make sense. So this actually I do want to use, but we'll use it later. And so here's a trick that I've done in previous projects. By the way, if you double click at this point in the track, it will make it smaller or bigger at a preset size, which is really convenient if you want to see keyframes and stuff. So we'll have the video just a little bit smaller and we can drag it up so that we have more area to work on for audio. Double click these. Now, I do want to use this clip because it's more dynamics, that wispy kind of so it's the sound of the wind changing speed and maybe going around corners and stuff. So once I've right-clicked mark in and then mark out the section that I want, I can then drag this. Oh, it doesn't work if you drag there. You have to click on this, drag audio only, down to this point. And that's now put it into our timeline. And the great thing is, if there's various sections that I listen to, like that, okay, I like that section, I'm gonna mark in, we're gonna mark out. I can then take that section and drag it down there. And I can even put it like over here. The great thing about the timeline is that you can use it kind of like a, it's like a desk. So if your desk is a complete mess, then you know exactly what to do. You drag whatever you want around your desk to where you don't need it. And then eventually when you do need it, you can just grab and pick it up like this stepper motor heatsink. Because that's a totally normal thing to have on your desk. Or a freshly greased head tilting servo. We'll get into that a bit later. If you want to see a Veyron 35 with the head tracking tilt thing, that will come up eventually. So will another battery video, but I digress. So basically you drag on whatever you want and you can just keep it on the side until you want to use it. And you can, you know, if you want to reuse stuff, because you're more than welcome to, try not to if you can, but if there's a particular sound effect that you want to use again and it just works, then, you know, copy, paste. Oh no, you see what's happened there. So this is the next trick. I'll undo that. You see this area over here where it says A1, A2, and A3. This is sort of an active selection thing. The same thing goes for the video side. But if you have these active, then what will happen is if you copy paste anything, it will use the first one as the first option for pasting. So if I, let's say, copy both of these at the same time, copy and then press paste, you see what's happened there? It's pasted into stuff that I don't want destroyed, and then the clip underneath it also carries the one that I copied there. Let's undo that. If I deselect A1 from that section there and then paste, ooh, see what happened? It's now pasted on the tracks below, and it's kept the same like top-bottom kind of vibe. And you can get the exact same effect if I deselect A2 and paste. Not only has it pasted on A3, but because there's another clip that needs to go below it, it's actually created a new track for me. And the new track will be handy in this particular case because there's a, in the original project file, you may recall I actually have four tracks because there's a certain point where I have up to three effects plus the music playing at the same time. So we can leave that there. So I'll just delete these. But now you know how all of this works. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to select these three tracks, A2, A3, A4, as available for pasting if I decide to do any copy-pasting. But, so this sound effect, this more wispy, windy sound, I'm going to use a little bit later, but I actually want a more deep, kind of like, ooh, mysterious vibe, impressive sounding vibe. And that sound, I believe, is... which one? Long whoosh, sound effect 8, wind in pine trees... oh, soft wind. There you go. Wow, that is soft. Now, here's another thing. I found that a lot of the sound effects available on the YouTube audio library, some of them are incredibly quiet. Their levels are so low that even listening on these laptop speakers, I'd have to like stick my head right next to the speakers to be able to hear and decide if it's something that I want. Now, luckily, if you have the Adobe Suite, you probably have Adobe Audition as well. And so when you get these files, you have the option of normalizing. And what is normalizing? Well, let me show you. Let's right-click this and let's see, open edit in Adobe Audition as a clip. It's gonna extract the audio, convert it to a WAV file. If you don't know, MP3 files are lossy, which means the compression actually reduces the quality of the file, such that if you save it again and again and again, it will degrade, just like a JPEG. But WAV files are like raw audio data, and you can save as many times as you want, and it won't degrade the quality. It's exactly as if there's no compression, it's just like, this is the sound. There you go. Highest quality you can get. So Adobe will convert it to WAV and then bring it into Adobe Audition. And the simple solution here is I go to Favorites and click Normalize to minus 0.1 dB. Which will make the noise now that big. And we can listen to it like that. Funnily enough, this is not what I did when I originally edited this video, but I will do it in this particular case because it does actually help us out a little bit. So Control S to save, and if I now close this and we go back to Adobe Premiere, soft wind audio extracted. If I double click that, you can see the waveform is what we just fixed. So let's use that. Let's drag, let's go from this point because I don't want it to start super quiet and just drag it to here. And now if we play back the footage, the wind is way too loud. How do we solve that? Well, easy couple ways. If this is small, you won't see it, but if you double click this and make it larger, you'll get this line, and this line is actually the volume of the track. So 0 dB is as it is. You know, positive amounts will make it louder, which we don't need because it's been normalized to 0. What you want to do is bring it down. So I can bring it down to, say, minus 8, and we can listen. And the crucial thing is this. If you look over here at the meter, where you can see the sound going up and down, you don't want that to hit red. Or if it does hit red, you don't want it to hit red often, just like maybe tickling red. In general, you want it to be below red. So if I actually leave this sound at 0, you see it hits red and it stays in the red. What does that mean? It means it's clipping. When sound hits the roof, it distorts and starts causing issues. And if you know anything about sound engineering, I know a little bit, and I used to work in the events industry, clipping sound and playing out of speakers has the potential for damaging the speakers. I'm not saying that playing out of a computer or a mobile phone is going to damage it, but what it will do is it will make the sound terrible. So you don't want to ever hit the red. So in my case, you know, I brought it down to what, -8? And now if I play it, it gets close to red. Doesn't touch it though. And that's the way you want it to be. So we now have the soft wind at the beginning. You'll notice that it kind of comes in abruptly, like the starting music. But I want it to start off a little bit softer. So let's go to effects and search once again. Just type in cross. Yeah, constant power. And I'm going to drag that here and drag it out so that it fades up the wind sound over time. Have a listen. Now I can hear it, right? And you notice the track, the sound itself, is fading down by itself as we get closer to the water. So I probably don't need to do that much with it. So maybe at this point is where I want the more wispy wind sound, since I'm closer to the water surface, to the actual dam. So I'm going to drag across this little doodad, and I'm not going to overlap it because I want it to play alongside as it kind of ends. So we'll just overlap it like this. So I'm not going to do this is what I mean. I'm not going to cut into the other thing. If I did that, I would be able to crossfade it like this. But then you're kind of fighting with when something ends and when the next thing begins. So I don't like to do this often. Sometimes I do it because I don't want to create a million individual audio tracks. I'll undo this and I'll just have it side by side like this. That will kind of end by itself naturally. This one can begin whenever I want it to, and I can just drag it to change it. We'll add another constant power to kind of fade it up from nothing. And you'll notice the audio levels on this, if I double click it, they're also not that loud. Now I could go into Adobe Audition and normalize it, but like I said, I haven't done that with all the other stuff. So what I'll just do, conveniently, I'll drag this line up to about 3, which is the equivalent of like a 50% volume increase. And then we can just have a listen. More. Let's do 6. Drag it up to like 6.8. There you go. Oh yeah. Maybe that's a bit too loud at this point now that this has faded. So what I can do, remember we keyframed the opacity of my watermark earlier? Sorry, not of my watermark, of the intro. You can see here where it starts off at, like, in this case, 50% now, and it goes up. So we can keyframe audio as well. So what you do is you click on the audio clip and you go to levels, and here it's already got the stopwatch active with no keyframe. To add a keyframe, we click on this little dot. And so this is the point where I'm happy with the volume. I'm okay with it being at 6, or let's just make it 6. So it's a nice round number. And I can drag it to the point where I feel like it's too loud and it needs to be quieter. And we can just set that back to, say, 0. And now you can see, even in the timeline on the clip, you can actually see the line of how that keyframe, how the volume is being brought down. And so that's, now at this point, I can even drag this line and change the level that it's sort of brought down to, or I could just drag the point itself. Other ways to edit it, although I like to be precise and do it in the effect controls section. So now if we listen, and now you can hear it just lingering. But you notice now our sound levels have started hitting the red. I think it's not quite there, it's just a little bit before here. So in the case of the sound levels do start hitting red, you're going to have to work out what you want to prioritize and what you don't want sort of clipping. So we can lower the volume of these additional sound effects quite easily. I could do a constant power here and like drag it all the way out there and fade it faster. And to some degree that works. I haven't hit the red yet. Ooh. So I've just hit the red because of that point. So I could just drag this down to say, let's click this arrow to lock to that point, and we will change it to say 4 instead of 6. Earlier it was 6. It's touched red on the right channel, on the left channel. So you notice it stays red to let you know that it's happened recently, but if you watch these little yellow lines, those are the actual points that it's hitting afterwards. So if I play from this point onwards, it doesn't actually hit red. So it means we're only hitting red at this point, in which case I could consider reducing the volume of the music itself. So let's try that. Let's set it to -3, right at the point where I got a spike. And we can set it back to -1 over here. Oh, not that one. We can set it back to -1 over here. So it's going to start off higher. It's going to come down to -3 at the point where we hit red. Just touched it on the right side. Didn't touch it on the left side. I'm kind of happy with that so far. And that can be it. But that's kind of the balancing game that you have to do throughout the whole video. And that's a big challenge. And the other aspect that you can do if you really wanted to get into it, I do the parametric equalizer, where if I know that there's like an intense sound of a certain frequency, let's say it's like deep wind noises, then I can pull down the low ends like this so that there is space for the low end sounds to come in, and then pull it back up when I know there's no more low end sounds. The exact same applies for if I edit audio for like when I'm speaking, I can pull down around 1K, which is roughly where vocals are, well, between 400 and 1K, I think. Correct me if I'm wrong, or don't, up to you. You can pull that down, and then my speaking can kind of fill that gap. And so the sound of the music can be higher, but still not clash with my vocals. So sound editing gets really intense sometimes, and this is what I do. I won't get into this right now, like I won't demonstrate exactly how to do it, because it gets really intense. I'll just skip ahead and we'll start adding more interesting sounds. All right, so here we are at a particular point in the video that I really like. It's the gap in the tree. I talked about it with great enthusiasm in the last video, so we'll have a quick look at it, and I think it's pretty obvious what I want to do with it, right? That's very much a kind of whoosh moment. So luckily I happen to have a whoosh over here. And if we actually listen to this original whoosh, I believe I downloaded this. This is one of those like YouTube free audio videos, and I think they gave a link to like 10 whoosh sounds, and this was one of them. Now this is an interesting one, because if you look at the waveform, unlike a lot of the other videos where the waveforms are roughly the same between the left and right channels, this one is drastically different. If we listen to it, it does this left to right thing, or actually right to left thing. You listen, or actually it's the other way around for you, isn't it? There you go. So that's not necessarily helpful for me, because I don't have any particular parts of the video where I'm like going around something, going left to right or right to left or whatever. But I do like the sound of it. And so what I often do with this particular clip is I duplicate it. So I copy paste. Oh, there you go. And now I got to put it back to the auto folder. And you see I've got two of them now. I'm going to rename them. One is going to be called short and the other is going to be called long. And the reason why is because much like we can retime the footage from 50 frames to 60 frames, you can actually go into here and modify. Instead of interpret footage, you have audio channels. And this is where we can actually tell it what's going to be right, what's going to be left, etc. So if this is the short one is the right channel. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell the left to just be the right. It's like, okay, And now you see, I have both channels exactly the same. Yeah. And of course, we can do the exact same thing with the other one. We go to Modify, Audio Channels, and we select Left for the right channel. And now we have this. So now we've got our whooshes in order. We have a short whoosh and we have a long whoosh. And then we also have Sound Effect 8, which is a really, really short whoosh. It's a comically, like, this is like a comic book whoosh. Like, so I don't use that often. Sometimes I do. Sometimes if it's hidden amongst a bunch of other sounds, that it can give you that little bit of impact and it kind of works. But in my case, no, we need a nice long one. So we're going to take this long one here and we're going to zoom into our footage. Let's drag this open. It doesn't need to be big, but I don't know. It feels nice. We're going to scrub back a little bit. Oh, not there. That's too far. Okay, roughly here. So that's kind of where I want the whoosh. So let's just try that. Let's just drag the whoosh to roughly here and see what it sounds like. Well, there's a problem. It's way too early. Try now. Way too early. Okay. That's not bad. But it starts off too harshly. So well, we can go back to the effects and type in cross again, and we can take this constant power to kind of do a fade in and zoom in a bit more. And let's get it to fade to about this point. And now we can listen one more time. It's still a bit too early. Let's drag it back to this point. In fact, you know what? Now that I think about it, the only point that really needs the whoosh is this gap here, right at this point. And because that's quite a short moment, we don't need the long whoosh. So I was wrong here. So let's delete that. And we'll go to the long whoosh short. And we'll just drag that here. And once again, let's see where that point is. That's about here. So that's where we want the sound to be kind of loudest. So we'll tap this back. Again, Alt, arrow keys to move it. And now, we play it. Okay, a bit late. Now here's the other trick. Shift and Alt. Shift will kind of double the movement. So if I press that, it moves by about 5 frames. Okay, I want the peak of the sound to occur right as it passes through. There we go. Much better. And you know what? I think I'm going to reuse that the intro whoosh, that kind of low pitch thing over here, because this is quite a long section where I feel like the wind kind of, as we go past that hill where the wind kind of gets blocked, and it's just this, it should be this kind of silent whoosh or silent drone. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to turn that off. I'm going to paste the sound that I want. I'm going to start it roughly at the same time. And let's have a listen. Yeah. Excellent. I'm digging this. I can't even remember if this is actually how I did the original video, but this is kind of working for me now. And that's the crucial thing, right? You have to feel it. You have to see what's going on, hear what's going on, and do your best at the time that you're editing it. And, you know, there's so many videos I've done in the past where I go back and I'm like, oh, I should have done that differently. Oh, I should have done that differently. And unfortunately, 2020 hindsight. Or just changing techniques, changing improvements in your own kind of judgment or your creative style. It all has a large effect on how all this plays out. So in the end, you can't keep beating yourself up over something that you did 5 years ago and you wish you could redo, but you can't take it back. We're haunted by memories like this. Creative people. Anyway, or at least I am. Creative.
Yeah, I'm creative, I suppose.
Anyway, so that's the sound. And the only other thing that I want to add to this, you'll notice that I'm flying between two trees and there's a lot of leaves. So could I be cheesy, extra cheesy, and add the sound of leaves rustling? Totally. So let's have a look at this. Okay. I like the tail end of this section. I like the softness there. So let's just grab that, mark out, and drag this up. And we're going to drag that to roughly this point. And let's see. It's roughly there. Is that correct? Maybe a bit further forward. And let's make it a bit louder. Try. Maybe a bit too loud. But yeah, so that's kind of... There we go. That's not too bad. That's all right. And then just over here. Again, more like leaves. Yeah, I'm not hitting the branches, but there's no reason why I couldn't add a little bit of an effect. So let's take this section, mark in, mark out, and we can fit that. Let's keep it on the same track. So like the leaves rustling are on audio 4. And once again, we'll increase the volume there against the whoosh that's happening here. Yeah, that works. That was subtle enough. Yeah, okay, what about, let's make it louder and see what happens. Yeah, no, that works for me. So that's the leaf sounds. And then the only other place I can think of that needs a whoosh is this, the backflip. So this, surely this can be the long whoosh. Let's try. Let's just drag that there and see what happens. We'll reduce the volume because it's the only thing happening. Although, to be fair, I probably want this kind of windy drone where we start to climb. And that's roughly at this point, so we'll drag that there. Oh, way too early. Let's move that a bit further back. Again, Shift-Alt to tap it forward, and then... Too soon. How about here? Not bad. But again, it seems too long, doesn't it? So let's use the short one. Oh no, I missed that. Oh God, I've really missed it. Where's the transition? There's the transition. So it's, come on. Ah, my playback's getting choppy. And that's the thing. You'll find with a lot of programs, Adobe especially, the more junk you start putting into the timeline and the more stuff it has to process whilst you're playing it back, the more stuttery it gets. And this is the pain that you get when you edit, especially if you're going to add 3D text. That's why I tend to do the 3D text last, or at least if I do it early, I'll disable it while I edit the rest of the video. But anyway, here we go. Too late. There, come on. That was all right. Maybe a bit early. That's not bad. That works for me. That definitely works for me. And yeah, those are the kind of the crucial points. So for me, I would say this is the end of the sound editing section because, okay, I've only added this much, let's save the project temporarily. But if we go back to, let's open the actual project and we'll have a look once again at the complexity. You see all these sounds that are happening. I haven't made it that complex, actually. If I can, so like, what's this? This is the desert howling wind. So this is the sound of that kind of wispy, windy sound. And that I just have playing over this. The one thing you'll notice, I don't really have any gaps other than at the end here, where it's just the music, because it's the ending. I don't need to have any more sounds there. But throughout the whole video, I tend to put in a lot of ambience or ambiance, and that's basically how that all works. So I'm gonna call it because check it out. It's like, what time is it? 5? 5:30? 6? 6? It's almost 6. So 6. For me, that's it. I'm going to stop editing. It's been a long time. Again, sat here for like 4 hours trying to record this. So again, Don't say I don't love you. We'll leave it there. So that's part two. That'll be it. The one thing that I haven't touched on yet, some of you were hoping that I would, is the 3D text. And that really deserves its own video because the complexities involved in doing that. I mean, just to give you an example, like here, you see these posts, I have had to manually mask them out because even rotoscoping is way too slow. And you can see it's not perfect. You can see a little bit of the blue kind of glow there, which is the sky actually. In motion, it's fine. In motion, you don't notice that. But seriously, like doing all of this, oh, it was such a pain. Fantastic payoff, but such a pain. So if you like this video, please click like. Comment if you have any questions. I can probably answer them and maybe I'll make separate videos on anything like extra complex. But crucially, if you really want to see the 3D tech stuff, please subscribe, click the bell icon, blah, 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 all that stuff. And yeah, I will try to do my best to demonstrate how it's done. I've done these videos so far to show how I've made this particular video, but I haven't really done it in a way that's like, okay, this is the process if you're doing it from complete scratch. So if you like something along those lines, like choosing GoPro settings, like why you need ND filters and shutter speeds for future video, like I've actually got this, it's disconnected now, but this is a Veyron 35 with a tilting naked GoPro and Cadex Vista. So this is all stuff that I wouldn't mind making videos on. And now that I have a bit more free time, I can kind of work on that. But ultimately, it's up to you. If you want to see more of this stuff, then please let me know. Otherwise, thank you for watching, and I'll see you in part 3.